All right, so it has been 21 years since the declaration of the Code of Conduct on the South China Sea has been discussed. We still see no Code of Conduct on the horizon, on the near horizon. How do you think that the recent events last week would actually affect talks with regard to the crafting of the COC?
Well, I am a skeptic on the prospects for the Code of Conduct to ever actually become it would never actually be signed between ASEAN and China, at least in the near term, while China is feeling like they are getting what they want through their current coercive methods. So, in fact, what I have said in the past and even this week is if ASEAN were to enter into a weak code of conduct without strong enforcement mechanisms, with China, then China would then turn that code of conduct into the new rules of the road, right? And then they would say, well, you know, that whole thing about, you know, the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea and that 2016 Arbitral Tribunal ruling, those are clearly don't apply, and ASEAN has agreed that the new rules are this code of conduct. So, you know, even the ASEAN nations have to be very careful in coming, you know, trying to make this code of conduct, which has been in development for so long. If they end up with something that is weak or is too deferential to China, then what they will end up with is a weaker position in the end.
And how do you think the regional bloc, ASEAN, has been criticized repeatedly for producing supposedly weak statements when it comes to the South China Sea issue, considering that most of its members are non-claimant countries in the South China Sea? How do you think can the regional bloc strengthen its position, not just with regard to the South China Sea, but as a vital power, as an important figure when it comes to geopolitics, given that they have already this kind of image, this kind of impression in the international community?
Yeah, I don't think that ASEAN, I think that, you know, we have to keep our expectations of ASEAN in check. I think ASEAN remains a useful body for conducting deliberations on a number of issues, but they're not going to be able to take strong stands on security measures simply because the interests of the member states are at current too divergent, and each state has such very different emphases for how it wants to conduct its foreign policy. So it is not, you know, it's not going to become anything like a military alliance or even a strong bloc that speaks with one voice on contentious security issues. I think we just have to kind of keep our expectations in check there.
All right, got it. Not an optimistic news for the Philippines there. Let's talk about the BRP Sierra Madre. It has been anchored there for decades already, since the 90s. It's decaying, frankly. It's deteriorating. And China is expected to take control of the area once it falters. What can the Philippines actually do to refurbish it, to actually improve the situation of its lone outpost there?
Right, right. Well, that is a challenge, and that is the ongoing challenge. So China has effectively carried out a blockade of the Sierra Madre now for many years. And this is one of those things that it managed to do in relative, without paying much of a reputational cost for it, in part because people are hesitant to use the word blockade. Blockade has long been considered an act of war, and people have been afraid of what the implications if we actually say this it's a blockade. And yet, if you look at the pictures from Saturday, there's no doubt that there's a blockade, right? When China controls access and denies access to ships or boats that it doesn't like, that is what a blockade is. And so in order to think about this in a holistic sense, first of all, we need to make China pay that reputational cost for committing this blockade on a Philippine outpost within its own exclusive economic zone. Secondly, there needs to be serious discussion about what lifts, circumvents, defeats a blockade. There are historical examples of how to defeat a blockade without going to war. The U.S. Relieved the blockade of West Berlin after World War II, when the Soviet Union and Eastern Germany blockaded that city, and it did it through a very aggressive transport plane. We call it the Berlin Airlift. So there are innovative ways to go about this. I wouldn't want to get too deep into what they might be, because of course Some of those may require a lot of secrecy and planning, and frankly, I'm not in those discussions, and I believe and hope that they're going on now. But you know, we have to reframe this discussion around the idea of we're talking about the need to either lift, circumvent, or defeat a blockade.
All right. And what's stopping the Philippines from actually calling on its allies for aid with their when it comes to reinforcing the BRP Sierra Madre there? You have a lot of ordinary Filipinos asking online that after the U.S., Canada, Japan, Australia, and even South Korea already gave out statements of support for the Philippines over the recent incident last week, what's stopping the government from actually seeking for their aid, for their support? To again help the BRP Sierra Madre's condition?
Well, to be fair, we don't know the government's not doing that, right? And it does have one treaty alliance with the United States. And I would hope and believe that probably there is joint planning going on even now on options for what could be done. Now, that's going to take the political will in Manila and Washington, D.C., both. In order to come up with some kind of a way forward. And those are the conversations I hope are happening right now.
Mm-hmm. Shifting a bit on a slightly different topic, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., if you recall, during his state visit to Beijing in January, established a direct communication line with the Chinese government to avoid miscalculations in the West Philippine Sea. But you have the DFA, the Department of Foreign Affairs of the Philippines, saying earlier this week that those communication lines with China were unreachable during the height of the scuffle in the West Philippine Sea. What do you make of that?
Well, to begin with, this was not an unplanned event. This was not a crisis for China. They planned for this. You can see it by the way they arrayed their forces, the sheer number of ships that were in the area. I've documented that there were 32 militia ships at nearby Mischief Reef even before this started. That's an astonishingly high number historically. Just to give context, in May there were three. So 3 to 32 is a big jump. There were six Coast Guard vessels that the Philippine Coast Guard documented, plus four PLA Navy. So the China planned for this event. They expected the rotation to happen. It was about the time that these rotations happen, and they pre-positioned their forces. So when the China saw the phone ringing, they had clearly planned ahead of time not to answer because they wanted the Philippines to know that this might be a crisis for you, but it's not for us.
So, well, putting it bluntly, the crisis hotline, the direct hotline, seems to be useless.
Right. I think we have to rethink how we think about crisis communications with China. In the Cold War, the U.S. and the Soviet Union, because both sides were highly concerned about a nuclear exchange, established a crisis hotline to make sure that there were no miscalculations. If one side or the other side saw something happening, they wanted somebody to be able to pick up the phone and say, don't worry about that, that's just an exercise, or don't worry about, we're just moving something around. China uses crisis communications as one more tool in its gray zone toolbox to, they know that other countries value crisis communications more than they do, and so that makes it a bargaining chip for them. So I think that's the way to think about this. China simply does not look at crisis communications as important as the U.S. or the Philippines does. So for that reason, they're using it as a bargaining chip.
Mm-hmm. And finally, we saw or we heard President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. giving a statement, an indirect assertion that the Philippines, at least under his administration, would not kowtow to Beijing's whims. When should the Philippines actually draw the line when it comes to China? Because clearly, over the past years, these talks did not bear fruit.
Yeah. So, I mean, I think, again, I think we have to start with saying that the Philippine government already has started to draw the line, right? Simply making all of these incidents public. These incidents are not unprecedented. They're just now public. And that's part of the government starting to draw the line. That is a weapon that the Philippines has in its toolkit, which is that it is in the right. And these images and these videos are powerful, and they rally international support. Now, again, that's a necessary but not sufficient condition to resolve the issue in the Philippines' favor. And by the way, probably a very long-term issue. But I think that the Philippines has already begun to draw the line and is now strengthening its U.S. alliance. It's strengthening its other security partnerships. It is embarking on joint patrol soon. One would hope that part of drawing the line would be taking a look at budgets and saying, are we adequately funding things that involve the Navy, the Air Force, the Coast Guard, those parts of the Philippine security apparatus that have West Philippine Sea responsibilities. That's something else that obviously the Philippines will need to think about.
All right, and we will have to leave it at that. Here's to hoping that the Philippines can soon expand that toolkit against Chinese incursions. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, maritime security expert Ray Powell.
Thank you.